Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to all of you. This is the final webinar in the 2021 Sri Lanka State of the Economy Report Launch Webinar Series. I'm Lakshila Vanigasinghe, and I will be your moderator this afternoon. The State of the Economy Report is the annual flagship publication of the Institute of Policy Studies of Sri Lanka. This year's report focuses on the theme, Pandemics and Policy, Protecting Health and Promoting Economic Recovery. The topic of discussion for today is Equity in Recovery, Addressing Sri Lanka's Social Protection and Food Security Needs. Now we have a short video lined up for you that will set the background for today's discussion.
COVID-19 has led to massive disruptions in the lives and livelihoods of people across the world. Millions of people have been pushed into poverty, reversing the global movement towards poverty alleviation. In Sri Lanka too, the pandemic had significant effects, particularly on low and middle income groups. The World Bank estimates that over 500,000 Sri Lankans have fallen into poverty due to the pandemic, which has led to an increase in the $3.20 poverty rate from 9.2% in 2019 to 11.7% in 2020. This implies a reversal in the progress made towards poverty reduction in Sri Lanka since 2016. A rapid household survey conducted by IPS across 10 districts during April and May 2021 shows that about 80% of respondent households experienced a reduction in their income during the first wave of the pandemic. In the second wave, about 60% of the households indicated a fall in income. This decrease in household income was primarily due to employment-related shocks such as permanent job losses, temporary job losses, lack of work, and reductions in salaries and wages during the pandemic. Sri Lanka's low social protection coverage, with only 29% of the workforce covered, offers scant security during a severe shock. The emergency cash transfers too suffered from mistargeting that continues to dodge Sri Lanka's national poverty alleviation programs. Sri Lanka must move towards a more consolidated social protection system that broadens coverage and improves on delivery mechanisms to help prevent vulnerable populations from falling further into poverty. The health and well-being of people during pandemics are also acutely threatened by food insecurity and malnutrition. Affordability and physical access to food have been the most impacted, with poorer households hit harder because food remains a much higher proportion of their household spending. With Sri Lanka's food price inflation at a high 10.3% in May 2021, the threat of households cutting down on food intake and worsening the country's already poor nutrition indicators is high. Globally, as protectionist attitudes to food production intensified during the pandemic, Sri Lanka's policy sentiments to support increased self-sufficiency in food production appear set to last beyond the immediate crisis. There are legitimate grounds for concerns that synthetic fertilizer and pesticides lead to health and environmental damages. However, the decision to ban its importation will run up against major demand and supply-side challenges in converting Sri Lanka's agricultural production into a 100% organic system amid a hurried implementation. For detailed insights, read IPS's Sri Lanka State of the Economy 2021 report. Focused on the theme of pandemics and policy, protecting health and promoting economic recovery, the report examines some of the critical socio-economic issues and policy choices facing Sri Lanka today.
All right, before we jump into today's session, I would like to mention a few housekeeping items. First off, today's webinar is scheduled for 1 hour, including the question and answer session. Participants can submit their questions throughout the session in the Q&A box below. The media has been invited to cover this event, and the webinar is currently being recorded and live streamed on the IPS Facebook page and YouTube channel. A recording of this session will be made available on the IPS YouTube channel at the end of the event. Finally, you can follow IPS on social media. We are available on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. Our Twitter handle is @TalkEconomicsSL, and you can use the hashtag SOE2021 for live updates. Now, without further ado, Actually, today's webinar will start with two presentations by IPS researchers, followed by commentary from two external commentators. Finally, we will move on to the Q&A portion of the webinar. Now, I would like to invite our first presenter this afternoon, Dr. Ganga Tilakaratna, Research Fellow and Head of Poverty and Social Policy, Welfare Policy Research at IPS. Over to you, Dr. Ganga.
Thank you, Lakshila. Let me share my screen. Good afternoon, everyone. So my presentation is going to be on social protection for vulnerable groups during pandemic. We all know that the COVID-19 pandemic has led to massive disruptions in the lives and livelihoods of people across the world. It has pushed millions of people into poverty, and estimates have shown that around 120 million people have fallen into extreme poverty it has pushed millions of people into poverty, and estimates have shown that around 120 million people have already fallen into extreme poverty in 2020 alone. The estimated numbers are even higher based on the $320 a day poverty line, around 228 million. With a larger share of these new poor are emerging from South Asia. And a World Bank study has estimated that over 500 million people in Sri Lanka too have fallen into poverty due to the pandemic. This, as you can see from the map, has increased the $3.20 a day poverty rate from 9.2% in 2019 to around 11.7% in 2020, implying basically a reversal in the progress made towards poverty reduction since 2016. So in response to COVID-19, countries around the world have adopted various social protection measures based on their existing programs or designing new ones. Now, these include social assistance programs like cash transfers and in-kind support assistance, and social insurance programs like unemployment benefit, health insurance support, and social security contribution waivers, as well as labor market programs like wage subsidies and training measures. Now, interestingly, a study by the World Bank has found that about 55% of these social protection measures taken in response to COVID-19 globally over the past 1 year in transfers. And as you can see from the map, the social assistance measures have been used widely across all regions in the world. And in South Asia, this has accounted for 75% of the total social protection measures taken in response to COVID-19. Now, Sri Lanka too adopted social assistance measures, in particular cash and in-kind transfers. The main social protection measure during the first wave of the COVID-19 was a cash transfer worth of 5,000 rupees per month, which was carried out in two consecutive rounds. This was based on six key programs, existing social protection programs: Samurti cash transfer, elders assistance, disability assistance, assistance for kidney patients, as well as farmers and fishermen's pension schemes. And this scheme included the existing beneficiaries of these programs as well as the waitlisted beneficiaries. And in addition, the new beneficiaries identified by the rural committees that were set up at the village level were also included in this scheme. So in the first wave, the cash transfer program showed a horizontal expansion in terms of its coverage. In total, it covered around 5.9 million individuals. and which is almost double the total number of regular beneficiaries of the key social protection programs considered under in designing this relief measure. Now, this 5,000 cash transfer measure in the first wave also indicated a vertical expansion. That is, higher the benefits given to the beneficiaries were actually higher compared to the pre-COVID-19 level. So the horizontal of the beneficiary, but actually the level of generosity varied. A Kamurthy program got the 5,000 rupee on top of their regular benefits, indicating sort of over 100% increase in their benefits. But the recipients of the disability assistance and the kidney patients assistance simply received their regular payment of 5,000 rupees. Now, in the second and third wave also, this cash transfer program was continued, and the cash transfer program was actually carried out in three more rounds in the second and third wave. But there were some changes in terms of coverage and benefit amount. Now, the main change from the second wave was that the benefits were actually confined to just one 5,000 or 2,000 payment per family. I mean, which is actually somewhat different to what happened in the first wave, where multiple payments were allowed per family. And in the third wave, as you can see, so the amounts were actually limited to 2,000, and the beneficiaries were also confined to those who aren't beneficiaries of existing social protection programs. And in addition to this cash transfer program, from the second wave onwards, an in-kind transfer measure also was carried out by the government, which included a 10,000 worth of dry ration. Now, IPS carried out a rapid household survey this year, early this year, to look at the impact of COVID-19 and the effectiveness of the government's social protection measure, which actually brought out some interesting findings related to the 5,000 cash transfer program. So the survey found that the majority of the recipients of the 5,000 cash transfer were relatively low-income households, with over 70% of those the recipients in both waves actually had their monthly income less than 25,000 a month in the pre-COVID period. And about 50% of the recipients were from the regular, were actually regular beneficiaries of the other social protection programs like Samurdhi. The majority of these beneficiaries were actually from the Samurdhi program. And the study also found that about 95% of the recipients had used the 5,000 grant to purchase food. And more interestingly, all recipients in our survey sample stated that the 5,000 payment was very helpful, or helpful actually to meet their needs during this pandemic. And out of that, the majority stated that it was extremely useful to meet their needs during the pandemic. Now, the most, with regard to the method of collecting, the most common method of collecting 5,000 was actually through some of the bank, GNO, post office. So majority in all the they've mentioned that they have collected the payment from the nearest some of the bank or GNO office. Now, with regard to the efficiency, interestingly, the majority of the recipients found that the 5,000 payment distribution process was somewhat efficient, or in fact, very efficient in their respective divisions, but there were just under 10% of households that stated that the process was inefficient in the second wave in particular. Or if not, you know, some even stated that it was very inefficient. So we also saw, actually remember, many implementation gaps in the media in the initial rounds of the payment, such as delays in payment distribution and long queues to collect cash, etc. So while some of these issues may have been addressed to a great extent in the later rounds of cash transfer distribution, it is actually important to look at in detail what were the root causes for these implementation gaps or these inefficiencies. Now, first, actually, the existing social protection system actually was not prepared to face such a large scale crisis and to cover such a large number of new beneficiaries who generally fall outside the existing social protection system. And secondly, the current system is a fragmented system with parallel structures and with several programs, but little or no coordination among these programs. And third, the system actually lacked an integrated beneficiary database. So what actually we had was just the beneficiary list or wait list of individual social protection programs. So the committees appointed at the divisional level actually had to identify other potential beneficiaries who are not part of the existing scheme within a short period of time. And also, there was lack of an efficient delivery mechanism, as we saw from the findings of the survey too. Many have collected the cash transfer program from the some of the office or the post office. Basically, it's a manual process. And finally, the gaps in the existing programs, such as low coverage and targeting issues, also have contributed to these inefficiencies. So moving forward, now there are various measures that, you know, to address the gaps and to strengthen the social protection system in Sri Lanka. Now, here I'm going to identify three policy measures. First, broadening social protection, basically broadening social protection to include those who are currently left out of the social protection system or the so-called missing middle. Is very important, and this is key to achieve universal social protection too by 2030, which is a target of the 2030 Agenda on Sustainable Development. This would require increased investment in social protection as well as designing new programs and building adaptive social protection to absorb new poor is also an important step towards broadening. It is also important to integrate the current social protection system, which is highly fragmented. This is very important to improve the efficiency of the system by reducing the administrative cost and addressing program overlap and exclusion issues. And finally, it is time for Sri Lanka to move towards digital payment systems to ensure efficient and safe delivery of cash transfers. However, it is important to ensure that those vulnerable groups with difficulty in accessing digital mechanisms are not excluded in this process. So with these thoughts, I'm going to conclude my presentation. Over to you, Lakshila.
Thank you, Dr. Ganga. That was very insightful. Now, the second presenter for today is Dr. Manoj Tipatwawa, who is a research fellow and head of agriculture and agribusiness development policy research at IPS. Over to you, Dr. Manoj.
Thank you, Lakshila. Let me share my slides. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to present building resilient agriculture value chains during COVID-19. So basically, you know, the agriculture sector makes a significant contribution to the economic and social development of the country and also the food and nutrition security of Sri Lanka. The sector accounted for 7% of the country's GDP and generated 21% of national export earnings, equivalent to about $2.5 billion in 2019. Also, the sector employs a part of the country's labor force. So its importance is even larger in rural areas where agriculture engages over half of the workforce. So COVID-19 pandemic has deepened existing vulnerabilities concerning agriculture, food and nutrition security in Sri Lanka, especially agriculture supply chains were crippled in the early days of the lockdown, and disruption of supplies created the backsliding effect spreading towards the producer end of the value chain, resulting in shortage of agriculture inputs, income losses for farmers and low farm gate prices. Also, the ability of consumers to buy food was severely affected by a collapse of food distribution due to restricted transport and storage facilities, and also the closure of major markets. Containment measures, different containment measures eroded people's access to food, especially in poor and marginalized households, and leading to price spikes. So within this background, I'm going to broadly look at the impact of the pandemic on the food system with the aim of making some policy recommendations to increase the food system resilience. So let's look at the pre-COVID-19 food supply situation of the country. Domestic food availability in Sri Lanka is largely determined by domestic production and imports. So, domestic agriculture provides approximately 70% of the food requirement in 2019. Only about 30% of the food requirement is imported. So Sri Lanka is nearly self-sufficient in rice, the staple diet item of Sri Lanka, and local production of the other main plant-based food sources also exceeds 75% of the total availability. As you can see in the graph, Sri Lanka produces a variety of pulses that include mung bean, cowpea, black gram, and soya bean. Domestic production share of animal protein products such as meat, milk, fish, and eggs also exceeds 85% of the total availability. Let's look at the food import situation. Food and beverages imports account for about 10% of the total imports into the country. These items mainly consist of milk products, fish and fish products, sugar, onion, and spices. Sri Lanka heavily depend on imported milk powder, about 55 billion rupees in 2019. So basically, milk powder, fish, sugar, and onions, these four products account for about 60% of total food beverages imports in the country. Other than that, there are some other major food imports include spices, potato, chili, other pulses, etc. Let's look at the changes in food supply during COVID-19. As the figure shows, you can see that domestic production has seen only minimal disruptions due to COVID-19. Harvesting of the 2020 maha season crops had already been completed by the time the first wave of COVID arrived in March 2020. Also, the crop production in 2020 maha is relatively better than that of 2019 maha. Especially in terms of paddy, maha production was about 3.1 million tons, which is 23% above the previous 5 years average. The production of the 2020 yellow was also generally favorable. Production of paddy was 1.9 million tons, which is about 27% above the yield of the previous year. Paddy production in 2020 maha was also almost equal to the previous year's production. Other domestic crops too showed a relatively better production than in the previous year. However, lack of access to inputs due to the ongoing waves of the COVID-19 and the recent government policy changes on banning inorganic fertilizer and agrochemicals is expected to see mixed performance in this session. Here, main food imports in Sri Lanka, you can see no significant change in food imports due to COVID-19 has been observed until 2020. However, there may be a reduction of certain food items in 2021 due to import restrictions. The share of food and beverages in total imports has been 10% in 2020, which is a significant increase from 7% recorded in 2018 and 2019. During the first 5 months of 2020, the contribution of food and beverages to total import was 9%, which is equivalent to the average share recorded in the last 3 years. So this could be a slight reduction in the level of food imports in 2020 when the increased prices are concerned. So the national level food availability aspects as discussed above indicate only a slight impact from COVID-19 on domestic food supply. However, there were some impacts on micro level dynamics of food supply, such as labor mobility, access to inputs, output quantity, prices due to containment measures and import restrictions. So I'm just going to discuss some of the micro level impact of COVID-19 based on a farmer rapid survey conducted during November-December 2020 to capture the variation between the pre-pandemic situation and the pandemic situation. Here you can see the labor mobility restrictions. You can see some micro level labor mobility restrictions have been observed compared to the situation before the pandemic, with 11% of farmers not having worked on their farm, or some use less hired labor on their farm or work less as hired laborers on others' farm. About 26% of the farmers had spent lesser number of days during the pandemic on their crop cultivation. When we look at the input use, you can see approximately 24% of farmers planted less seed compared to the same season last year, while only 2% didn't have access to seed. Additionally, about 23% of the farmers used less fertilizer and only 4% didn't have access to fertilizer. With regards to use of chemicals, also about 40% of the farmers used fewer chemicals and only 3% didn't use chemicals. Here you can see the input price dynamics. A relatively significant percentage of farmers had problems related to the price of different inputs. But 49% of farmers had to pay a higher price for purchasing seed, while 35% had to pay a higher price for chemicals. In terms of fertilizer, the percentage of farmers who had to pay high price was about 27%. So this can be related to the restrictions on importing certain inputs as well as logistical problems due to the COVID-19 pandemic. This is output dynamics. As you can see here, about 24% of farmers had received an output lesser than the previous year. About 33% of farmers had received a relatively low output price during the same period. So these things reveal the inherent problems of marketing in agriculture, where farmers often fail to receive a fair price. The other problem that the people faced was rising food prices. Despite different measures to ensure food security, markets across Sri Lanka saw price spikes for food commodities due to the logistical challenges posed by the pandemic and the lockdown. Especially the National Consumer Price Index for food increased by 11% from March 2020 to May 2020, as opposed to an overall price inflation of only 6% during the same period. You can see here rising price and also other prices also fluctuated the same way during this period. So the food system is organized as interconnected value chains. Food value chains are complex systems that link different economic actors such as producers, collectors, wholesalers, retailers, processors, likewise, and also the supporting players. So there are several challenges in the value chains affecting the food system resilience in the country. So we need a value chain analysis using rice and the vegetable value chains to understand the problems of the value chains that cause the affected the resilience of the food system. So with regard to the main challenges in the value chain, producers are poorly connected with the markets and intermediaries gain arbitrage opportunities. By contrast, rural producers receive lower prices due to lack of market information, poor infrastructure, small-scale production, weaker bargaining positions, and lengthy marketing channels. Also, some other major constraints in this value chain include inefficient resource management by farmers, inadequate availability of quality seeds, inadequate use of modern techniques, seasonality of production, high percentage of post-harvest losses due to inappropriate handling, storage, transportation, so things like that. Also, despite various forms of incentives by the government to promote value-added products, the share of value-added products is also very low. So, what we understood from this analysis is, without addressing structural issues pertaining to the food system, it is unlikely that short-term and medium-term intervention can help to create a resilient food system. Some of the recommendations that we made are as follows: ensuring a smooth supply of inputs. Currently, most of the required fertilizer is imported, and timely distribution of fertilizer disease has been an issue in the country. This issue was multiplied during the pandemic season. As such, proper distribution of fertilizers should be taken care with appropriate measures to prevent misuse and overuse. So government should also look to and adopt technologies that require less use of chemical fertilizer. Further, given that the demand for organic agriculture has been increasing around the world and also in Sri Lanka, gradual adoption of organic agriculture practices is necessary. Also, Sri Lanka needs to strengthen its storage capacity and maintain a buffer stock of essential food items as National Food Bank. Also, establishing farm market linkages between farmers and buyers. This will establish transparency in pricing and better value, especially for perishable products. It would also help to increase farmer incomes and enable downstream players to source more effectively by eliminating intermediaries. Also, agriculture extension services and information dissemination. It is very important to improve the coordination and collaboration of programs from central governments, ministries and agencies between the central and sub-national governance structures. Moreover, the agriculture sector in general could utilize some digital technologies to reach the beneficiaries, so that this current situation could be taken as an opportunity to familiarize farmers with digital agri-extension services and information systems. The increase in demand for digital marketing platforms during this COVID-19 pandemic should be capitalized to promote the capacity of e-commerce at both ends of the supply chain. One of the major reasons why farmers agree to low farm gate prices is the advance or loans they take from the collectors. Since farmers' access to formal credit is limited, they usually resort to existing networks to informally borrow money, which pushes them into less beneficial sales contracts. So that's concessionary credit schemes and simple procedures in providing loan facilities for agricultural activities and agro-based industries, including post-harvest loss reduction, should be introduced through state and private banks. Also, continuous monitoring of the food system is very much needed. A regular monitoring system can safeguard the local food supply from international trade restrictions as well as possible malpractices by local traders, such as trade current issue in the rice milling industry in Sri Lanka. So this regular monitoring can collect the data on domestic food production, import, domestic and world market prices, input availability, transport and logistic systems. Also, poor quality and safety assurance mechanism and insufficient traceability along the entire value chain is also a fundamental issue in agriculture value chain in Sri Lanka. So, strengthening market linkages and for resilient value chains will require effective learning and training measures for producers, especially on post-harvest technologies such as grading, weighing, sorting, packing. So these things are necessary. So popularizing the already developed good agricultural practices by the Department of Agriculture, incentives for smallholders, and making this mandatory with target timeline could be done to ensure quality supply of products. So addressing industrial issues about processing is also important, and also food related social security programs. I'm not going to cover this aspect because the previous speaker covered this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manoj. All right, so now we can move on to the external commentary portion of today's session. For this, first, I would like to invite Professor Dileni Gunawardana. She is a professor of economics at the Department of Economics and Statistics at the University of Pera Delhi. Over to you, Professor Dileni.
You let me share my screen and okay, so let me congratulate both the researchers for this excellent two chapters that we are reviewing today. And what I will do is I'll just provide some additional insights from the report chapter, some insights from other countries, which I think will be useful to put our situation in context, and then some thoughts on how we can build back better. So, as you can see from the survey that was done by IPS, many people lost their income and slid down into lower income brackets. As you can see from this, we can see that people who started off pre-pandemic in these brackets then moved to other brackets during the pandemic. And we have, in fact, no idea, but we can imagine that people who earned less than 25,000 ended up earning even less than that during this time. Dr. Tilakaratna pointed out to us some of the results of the survey. What the survey didn't tell us was about the intra-household dynamics. Within the household, which demographic groups were worst off? How did children fare? How did old people fare? How did women fare? Whose consumption was reduced? How was childcare and schooling handled? And something that I thought about was how did migrants, we know that many of Sri Lanka's citizens are overseas as migrants in other countries and they got stuck, unable to come back. They also lost their jobs. And these were people that our social protection network probably did not reach. How did their households back home fare? So these are, I think, questions that would be difficult to answer during this time, but are important questions for us to find the answers to in the future. Looking at overseas experiences in low and middle income countries, gender effects are quite prevalent. There's a far higher share of women who lost their jobs compared to men. And this is across country, low and middle income countries. Women were in the front lines. Women had greater care responsibilities because children were at home. And this spilled over to adolescent girls who had to then take over from their mothers. Remote schooling was inaccessible for children from marginalized communities. We can imagine that that may have been true in Sri Lanka as well. Learning was lost, just as in our country we had that. What happened to school feeding programs and school health programs? So there's some level of these that take place during the year, which are also part of our social protection. And those would not have taken place in the last 2 years. So children who perhaps say, for example, poor eyesight is caught during a health program, or many children may depend on a school feeding program to maintain nutrition. And these are effects that we can expect to see. Health access deteriorated because people did not want to go to doctors or hospitals for fear of catching COVID. And then domestic violence, as we know, has been on the increase because of people being at home. Going back to the IPS survey, they give us a sense of the coping strategies households used. And to me, the brightest side of it is actually that we have a large proportion of those who were interviewed who did not take any additional measures. So it looks as if maybe for many people, they were able to cope with the 5,000 that the government gave them and with without going to these other measures. But the other measures were reduced consumption expenditure, reduced non-consumption expenditure, pawning or selling your assets, informal sector borrowings, or withdrawing your savings, and formal or semi-formal sector borrowings. In other countries, we see missed meals, reduced portions of meals. We see 27% food insecurity among Rohingya refugees in Bangladesh, which is lower than the average. But in Kenya, food insecurity among refugees was higher. We see this saving. We see a decline in non-food expenditure. And we see that microfinance repayment rates plummeted. So this gives us a sense of some of the things that Sri Lankans may also have been doing during this time. Now, going on to the Sri Lankan response, I just want to draw your attention to the response in the first wave in terms of the number of beneficiaries and the response in the second wave. In the first wave, we actually have 5,963,404 beneficiaries, which is pretty high. If we assume, it is a wrong assumption, but if we assume that each beneficiary was in a unique household, that households didn't get more than one of these payments, then that almost covers the entire of Sri Lanka. So, of course, the answer to that is that households were eligible because many members may have been eligible for different things. And so there were some households that got more than one tranche of these payments. When we come to the second wave, that number has been brought down. And so it's a little less than 2 million who actually received any benefit during the second wave. Beneficiaries generally seem to have been pleased with the arrangements, with the targeting. They use cash transfers for food purchases, which shows us that people were going for their basics first. And about 20% reduced consumption, as we saw from the previous graph. Now, looking at social protection measures in other countries, between March 20th of 2020 and May 14th of 2021, there's a total of 3,333 social protection measures in 222 countries, and cash transfers have been the primary instrument. So we have been similar to many other countries. What this experience told us was that it's important to be able to quickly mobilize public assistance to vulnerable households. And the silver lining is that large-scale social safety net programming increased dramatically. Innovative delivery approaches have been developed and deployed at scale, and sophisticated targeting methods and low-cost mobile money transfers were also used. And that is, I think, what Dr. Tilakaratna is referring to in these better delivery systems. And that is indeed good news for us, that we can learn from other low and middle income countries. In concluding this chapter also talks about expanding coverage as well as including a broader range of benefits and the requirement for fiscal space to be able to do that. And I want to talk here a little bit about the broader range of benefits. I think when we talk about social protection, we are used to thinking of it as cash transfers, as a social safety net. But social protection can also be transformative social protection that actually changes structures of society. And childcare is one major way in which this can be done. And I think the entire world understood the value of childcare during this pandemic, as children were at home and needing more care. And people had a sense of how much time and effort goes into the care of children. School feeding programs, expanding the programs we have, that seems important. And then employment guarantee scheme, so that when people lose their jobs, they have something to fall back on that is not just a handout, but they're building roads or building infrastructure and getting paid for it. And then finally, as I already mentioned, the role of migrants. So let me stop there.
Thank you, Professor Delaney. That leaves us with our final commentator for the day, Professor Udit Jayasinghe. He is the secretary to the Ministry of Agriculture and also serves as the Vice Chancellor of the Wayamba University. Over to you, Professor Udit.
Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity And rather than having a speech, I wish to answer any questions, any queries that you have related to this topic. So it would be giving more opportunities for others to participate. Either I'm an economist, you know, agriculture economist, not a biologist. So rather it's for the policy analysis. I would be able to help you to explain anything. Any issues to be revealed or explored?
Yes. So we can move on to the Q&A portion of the session then. And we do have quite a few questions. So I will try to accommodate as much as possible. Okay, so that being said, I will ask you the first question, Professor Udit. It is, what are the reasons behind the continued high prices for pulses such as green gram, cowpea, other than the fertilizer issue and the pandemic?
Right, okay. So I'll be, there are two sides of this story. One side is prices, other side is fertilizer issue. What should I answer first? Shall I answer the price issue first? Is it okay?
Yeah, sure. Anything is fine.
Yeah, okay. So of course, when we talk about the agriculture, especially prices, nowadays people are not talking about especially pulses and others because they have good prices. Because prices are defined very differently in Sri Lanka. Some are very important for consumers, others are important for the consumer producers. If you go into the paddy only, which is important for both, right? So when you tell green gram, black gram, everything, when the prices are high, there is not much sound, and because producers are getting a good price then. And if others, they can easily substitute that one. That's what I see, substitute with something other, with protein or so on. So they are getting good prices, everybody is coming to market. But when it's come to the other agriculture crops, especially maize and rice, it is important for consumers. One is for human, other is for the feed market for, say, especially poultry. So that is, even we are not talking maize price, when it goes high every time, it indirectly affects human consumption through egg prices and all this that we might have be able to see in soon. But other thing is the paddy, there's another thing, whether when the price go up, consumers voice and noise is there. When it goes down, again, the other side, the producers or the farmers issue are there. The, what I see there from the policy point of view is how Sri Lanka is working on this very important crops and production. Minister of Agriculture, that we, I am not as a secretary talking, but as an agriculturist, agriculture economist for last 25 years that we have seen, you can see the production side of paddy is taken control by the Minister of Agriculture, Department of Agriculture, and Govijana Seva, you all these institutions. That is up to a certain level until harvest, I'm sure. So they ask for input management, technology management, subsidies, and everything for production. As soon as it is produced, harvested, that market goes into another group, right? It is a trade thereafter, domestic trade or either international trade, maybe importing, exporting. You can see these two are every time handled by two different ministries or different organizations, unlike in other countries. I know in Australia, Canada, all big countries, if it is a crop, it is handled by a single institution from A to Z. Canadian Wheat Board, I know, Australian, and all these pulses and others are controlled from producer to consumer, all markets, all value chain by a single unit, which is governed by the experts of that area based on statistics information. But here, even I can say the paddy marketing board is under our ministry. I have some authority to decide and control of it. But when it comes to the talks of paddy marketing board, it is usually the voice is coming from the trade side. So we don't know what is happening even. Who puts the control price? Who puts the floor price? Who put the ceiling price? We are also going to listen sometimes from other sources. So that control is not there, unfortunately. So prices are affected by these decisions. Sometimes markets themselves, producers are deciding price by themselves, and our political system, administrative system also set in prices for paddy, one side, prices for rice, other side. So prices for paddy is set by our ministry, 55, 65, whatever. And then the trade ministry is deciding its ultimate rice price, 145, 138, likewise. So this is the biggest issue. The decision making, starting from production to other coming into the consumer, is not controlled by a sort of single body in terms of input management and the processing, agriculture value chain, and so on. So I believe the price is the finally what is it, what it's going to be reflected. You know, in demand and supply curve, price and the quantities automatically to be decided. But here we fixed to buy a ceiling price or floor price or some way other. The quantities will not be adjusted accordingly. So economics is not working. Naturally, such decisions are taken by without considering these forecast or their productions and so on. So that is what I can say. So it is high time to take control of this pricing and supply mechanisms into the hands of experts who knows the forecasting, quantitatively pricing and decision making like in other countries, so that the political or administrative or other social systems are not interfering with such markets, right? Second thing, if you want to answer the question within next 3 minutes given time, the fertilizer, right? Fertilizer markets also, I'll be taking in that way, right? What I see here, the current problem is basically point of the way we define it, right? People are telling chemical fertilizer versus organic fertilizer, right? This terminology is also highly confused. To me, it is everything is chemical, right? Everything is a chemical because as we did from science, from grade 3 to 12, and even after up to PhD, everything in a fertilizer or in a product is a chemical. So it is a chemical fertilizer or organic fertilizer. To me, it may be defined as artificial or natural then easily. So when you say natural, it may be again organic or live. When we tell something natural, it is live. So the organic things, we automatically think they are natural or some living components are there. Rather, artificial things are either inorganic or they are chemicals. But rather, we should go into the right terminology of non-hazardous, non-healthy, or poisonous up to the environmentally friendly. So this is the new concept. That's a concept adopted everywhere in the world. Environmentally friendly fertilizers, right? So if this terminology is to be used, then we can easily go with the right product. We can make right decisions, right? Unfortunately, due to one reason or another, that advice or that instruction has not arisen. So now it has been understood very well. Our fertilizer market should be enriched with environmentally friendly, also non-poisonous or the non-hazardous materials. Then the problem is solved because we are facing a problem which is created by three things. What are these three things? First one, the wrong selection. Fertilizer for most people is the urea, MOPO, whatsoever. They don't know any other name even. fertilizer is urea for majority of people. So wrong selection. Urea is a good substance. It's not a bad substance. We are using in every product, starting from those high quality creams that we use on our skin. But a fertilizer, urea is considered as a now very bad chemical. It's a wrong interpretation, right? Then it's a wrong selection we have made. In the name of urea, we have brought the country into a very poor product. They are not even regularized. They are not urea. And even in the auditor reports last week, I have that one. They have very clearly mentioned this, this thing we have done. Non-registered, poisonous materials were brought. They are not even released through the ports without even testing. Then in wrong quantities, right? Any amount can be taken from anywhere. Right. If you want to have two tablets of amoxicillin, how many times you'll have to go to a doctor and then to the pharmacist and get a recipe and drink it morning and evening like that, even for six pellets of amoxicillin. But for six bottles of any fertilizer can be given to a grade six pass, any student. So this is wrong quantities are given, not adjusted into the demand. Finally, wrong financial or other incentives. For that, subsidies are given. Now you can think what has happened, right? For a wrong selection, wrong quantities, bad incentives given. Economically, biologically, every action was failed. Now, in the Saubhagya Act, the president wanted to correct that one very clearly. He wanted to bring the right plant nutrients into the country in right quantities, given to create right incentives for production. It has, we have very clearly written in policy documents, right? But that was misinterpreted maybe by others or due to some pressures and misinterpreted. Now we understood the phenomenon very well. We have worked very hard over the last few months to make it right. That's why we would be able to go on even up to the nanotechnology-based fertilizers to brought into country. And they have been understood as the world best and most modern plant nutrients available for anybody. So that's what I am telling. Those things that went wrong, we are now trying to correct by bringing right amount of nitrogen or phosphorus and potassium, because as I'm always telling, the plant doesn't know what it takes, right? It needs nutrients. We must know what to give. So therefore, all this fertilizer issue is an issue created by we in the system, political, administrative, even farmers, traders, legal system. All of us have some repercussions and decisions on it. So we need the support of people. Only way that we can solve. Again, one thing final, one last minute, our KPIs, key performance indicators. We measure performance by number of fertilizer tons used or number of that one given. No, it should be the food security point of view. Whether you have the accessibility to food, whether you have availability of food, whether you have correctly utilized the food, and finally, what's happening, given all these conditions, are we in a better food system in terms of markets and the government and judicial system? So that is our view. That's why the role of economists, policymakers are important rather than only biologists who make unwanted claims. So that was very clearly written in many books in US, in other countries. So if it is only the biology, if it is only the biotechnologies, if it is only the soil scientists, they will be going for the best or the optimum conditions. That is not feasible in a country like Sri Lanka, but we'll have to go economically best and affordable levels. That is my view as an economist. And now, as a secretary also, I am doing that one with the help of my people like you guys from the Institute of Policy Studies. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Udit. Our next question, Dr. Ganga, I will direct it to you. You mentioned that integrating the social protection system as an important measure to improve its efficiency. Can you elaborate on this? Are there any initiatives by the government in this direction? Dr. Ganga?
Yeah, Lakshila. So as I mentioned in my presentation earlier, so the current social protection system is actually a very much of a fragmented system. So there are a large number of programs implemented by different ministries, departments, and even there are programs by the provincial ministries, but there is hardly any sort of coordination among these programs. So this, in a way, has led to high admin cost and overlap of beneficiaries, as well as there is actually lack of transparency within the system. So what we actually need is an integrated system and a coordinated and unified structure from the national to sort of divisional level. So one of the key components of an integrated system is a central beneficiary registry, which will actually help to sort of avoid duplications of beneficiary and also help to improve transparency. So the government has taken some initiative in this direction under the social safety nets project, which comes under the Welfare Benefit Board. Initiatives have been taken to integrate beneficiary databases or registries of some of the key social protection programs. Initially, it's actually only four programs, like some of the disability assistance, elders assistance, and kidney patients allowance. But this is expected to be extended to other some of the other cash transfer programs as well. And another sort of an initiative is that a social protection strategy is also being formulated at the moment. But these are all at the very sort of initial stages, but we can take them as sort of positive steps to integrate the system. But we have a long way to go to build a sort of an integrated and sound system.
Thank you, Dr. Ganga. Dr. Manoj, we have a question for you. You talked about rising food prices relating to the pandemic. We have been facing a rice shortage and rising rice prices in recent years. Do you think that this rice price crisis is related to the pandemic? And what are the solutions that you propose for this? Over to you, Dr. Manoj.
Yeah, thank you, Lakshila. Actually, I think Professor Udit already discussed about the pricing mechanism in Sri Lanka in the agriculture. So rice pricing, we cannot exactly relate to the COVID-19 crisis, because we have been discussing this rice price crisis for a long time. Usually, rice market has a system of price determination associated with the availability, supply and demand in the market. So it's related to the seasonal harvests, Yala and Maha. So basically, there are certain months rice price is higher than the other months, especially from January. Price of paddy decline gradually and reach its lowest in March, because in March, Maha season harvest come to the market. So then it increases slightly from April, and minor slump during July, August, when the yellow harvest comes in July, August, September period. Then again, it starts to increase up to December. So this period is the very sensitive period, politically sensitive, that during the period September, January, the rice price is usually high. But recent times we experienced that severe disruptions happened to this usual pricing mechanism because of some cooperative decision making and anti-competitive practices by large and leading millers. In Sri Lanka, we have several types of millers, large millers, leading millers, few leading millers, large millers, custom millers, and small and medium millers. So these large millers, they have large storage facilities, purchasing power is high, and they have more economic stability. So inherently, they get the advantage in the market condition. So that's why this rice price situation is there. So best thing is to do is to strengthen small and medium millers so that the oligopolistic market can be broken, especially giving some incentives for small and medium millers. So I don't think we should go for like forcing like checking rate in the millers, their stores and things like that, or price mechanisms. So market should be allowed to determine the price, but small and medium millers should be strengthened to compete with the larger millers. And also, I think we need a system of, as Professor Udit mentioned, information limitation is one of the major limitation in agriculture. So for that, we need to have a good established market information system. Yeah, that's all.
Thank you, Dr. Manoj. So we do have a couple more questions. I will direct one question to Professor Delaney. COVID-19 has left working women around the world at a higher disadvantage than their male counterparts. How do you think this has affected the labor force participation rate in Sri Lanka? And what measures can we take to make sure the females that have adversely been affected rejoin the labor force? Over to you.
That's a good question. And I think some of these points came up yesterday in the IPS seminar as well. One of the things that was noticed was that the labor force participation of women has already decreased, so that the unemployment increase was less for women than it was for men, because women voluntarily dropped out of the labor force. And the reason for this, of course, is because they had much more to do at home. We have a gender division of labor that is very strongly ingrained in our society, where all the work that is done at home, the unpaid work, is done by women. So whether it is looking after children, whether it is looking after old people, whether it is cooking, cleaning, and so on, all of that is done by women. I think our Time News survey shows, I don't remember exactly that, the time difference, but it's a huge amount in terms of the number of hours per day and the number of days, hours for a week between men and women. So what this means is that for women to be able to go back to work, they need some support. And this is where social protection systems come in. I think it's high time that we developed social protection supported childcare systems, and not just employer driven childcare systems, but either employers getting subsidies from the government to do this so that it gives them an incentive, or government provided childcare systems, which will also then increase employment for women as well. So that's one thing. The other thing actually is that as we are looking to the future, we are becoming an aging country, as one report put it, becoming old before we become rich. And though we are not, rich enough, we need to think in terms of elder care systems as well. So that is an area for social protection to look at. So I would think those are two crucial things that will help women to then be able to join the labor force, because they have the education, they have the skills, they have the training, What they need is to have their time freed up so that they can join the labor force.
Thank you, Professor Dileni. So we do have quite a few more questions, but unfortunately, that is all the time we have been allocated for today because it's almost 4:10. So I would like to wrap up by thanking all of our presenters and commentators. Also, a big thank you to the audience for contributing to an engaging discussion. Unfortunately, we tried to accommodate all your questions, but we did miss a few. Finally, a quick reminder that the 2021 Sri Lanka State of the Economy report is now available for purchase. And on that note, thank you once again and have a great afternoon.